I'm Judy Brown, the Senior Vice President of Corporate Affairs at Amgen. In addition to leading critical work across communications, advocacy, community relations, and philanthropy, I also have the privilege of leading our environmental, social, and governance programs, developing strategies and helping lead the tactical plans to make the world a better place. At Amgen, we firmly believe that this is part of helping us build a better world and will be the topic of our discussion today. So, thank you for those of us who may be joining us from a wide variety of locations around the world. We look forward to hearing from you and hearing questions as we proceed through our conversation today. So, should you have any questions, just to let you know, we have in fact observed all COVID protocols for today's activity. We have all been both tested, we're wearing masks until just a moment ago, and are all vaccinated. So, safety first. Few fun facts about Amgen before we really get started. We are one of the earliest and leading biotech companies in the world. We were founded in 1980 in a hamlet of Los Angeles, which is now a thriving community of Thousand Oaks, California. And we've grown to be one of the leading players and leading independent biotechnology companies. We are reaching millions of patients every year around the world and continuing to develop a pipeline of innovative products. Our belief and core to our strategy is that innovative, highly differentiated medicines that provide large clinical benefits in addressing serious unmet needs in diseases such as cancer, heart disease, severe asthma, et cetera, are medicines that will not only help patients, but help reduce the cost of healthcare globally. And at Amgen, we believe we also have a critical responsibility to focus on serving these patients. Not enough just to address the creating the medicines, but that we have the privilege of impacting people's lives. And you'll hear more from my colleagues today talking about how they do that in their day jobs here every day. So we're gonna talk a little bit about ESG and the components of ESG. So maybe a quick primer. You can see on the screen, ESG stands for E, environment. How we are dedicated to practices that strengthen our business while reducing environmental impact. Check. Social, helping provide access to our medicines, as well as increasing diversity of our workforce and working on improving the lives of stakeholders through focus on diversity in clinical trials and other things you'll hear about. Governance. Strong governance has to be critical in all businesses, and we believe are extremely important in providing a strong foundation to creating long-term value for shareholders, as well as our community of stakeholders. At Amgen, we break our ESG story into four critical pillars. We talk about it in terms of healthy people, so working to advance health equity so that people can live their healthiest and best lives. This includes the diversity in clinical trials I just mentioned. Healthy society, working every day in any way we can to help create a more just society for our employees and our communities. A healthy planet, obviously, how we can leave the world a better place than the one we're in today by prioritizing sustainability and aiming to minimize our environmental impact. And, of course, a healthy Amgen, making sure that the company itself is being well-run, well-managed, and that our culture and products reflect our values. So, without further ado, I would like to now also introduce you to my panelists, my esteemed colleagues, Tamika Jean-Baptiste, who is our Vice President and Chief Diversity Officer, and Sam Guhan, our Vice President of Engineering. So, rather than have me talk anymore, let me let them introduce themselves. Tamika.
Well, thank you. First of all, thank you for this conversation. I think it's so important. My name is Tamika Jean-Baptiste. I am now celebrating my 20th year at Amgen. I know, time flies when you're having fun. And I lead our diversity, inclusion, and belonging strategies. And really what that means, Judy, is really strengthening our capabilities to create a diverse global workforce that truly reflects the patients and the local communities that we serve. That also means, you know, how do we activate our culture at Amgen to ensure that our staff members feel that they have inclusion and belonging so they can truly thrive while they're at this organization. And then third, really looking at efforts to really really embed diversity, inclusion, and belonging in our, you know, throughout our policies, our processes, and our practices. And I also get the great privilege of working with your team and with Sam's team on really looking corporately what we can do to do our part for society, and really looking for opportunities to build a more just and equitable society. So really excited about the topic and looking forward to discussing more of our DI&B efforts, as we affectionately refer to it as Amgen.
DI&B, we love acronyms. So we'll try and keep you abreast of those as we go along. And Tamika and her mighty team have been touching every aspect of the business in these last years. Sam, tell us about yourself.
Thank you, Judy, and thank you for including me in this event. I'm really happy to be here and happy to talk about environmental sustainability. To say just a couple of words about myself, I'm a chemical engineer, and I've been working in the pharma, biopharma business for about 30 plus years, close to 19 of which have been at Amgen. And at Amgen, I've had the privilege of having a diversity of experiences in R&D, in operations, and within operations in process development, manufacturing, and engineering. Currently, I'm the head of global engineering here. And as part of this, we are accountable for the design, build, and maintenance of all of Amgen's assets. That includes labs, offices, pilot plants, factories, all across the globe. But the reason I'm here today is, in addition to that, I'm also responsible for the EHSNS organization, which stands for Environmental, Health, Safety, and Sustainability Group. And today I'm excited to talk to you about our road to net zero as part of environmental sustainability. Thank you.
Years of experience up here. Thank you, Sam. And as you'll learn, he's a very passionate engineer when it comes to sustainability. So, reminder, if everyone could jot down any questions you might have, we are looking forward to a robust Q&A at the end before we go through some quick banter up here. So without further ado, getting into quick quiz. Okay. Tamika.
Yes.
If you had to come up with one word that would define ESG in your mind at Amgen, or our ESG journey, what would it be?
I would say evolving. And we'll talk a little bit more about why I feel that.
I love a journey.
Yeah.
Okay. Sam, do you have a word, a buzzword?
Well, I'm a scientist and an engineer, and Amgen is a science-based company. My word has to be innovation, and I will talk more about that during the rest of this conversation.
All right. Sounds good. Now I want to know more. I guess my word would be intrinsic. And that would be because I truly feel we're pretty lucky here with our ESG program, because Amgen's mission to serve patients has built into us a very clear, purpose-driven way of thinking about the world. So rather than having to come up with a program or invent something, it's built into literally everything that this organization does every day. And frankly, is one of the reasons I joined 5 years ago, is that sense of shared purpose and that real belief that what we do, we can do well, we can serve patients and leave the world a better place, and hopefully have a really positive impact on our employees and communities at the same time. It fits in really nicely, and the elements of our ESG program, which you'll hear more about, really do encompass those areas. So today, I would love to talk about all of our ESG components, but there are a lot. Please feel free to read our ESG report. Today, we're going to focus a little bit more on areas around social justice, DI&B, and climate change. You go on about all of these topics, and I think, frankly, when you get into them in more detail, you realize how fast both of these have accelerated just in recent history. And yes, there's been a pandemic, and yes, there's been a lot of change for each of us individually as humans, but the focus that we have all been placing around your dinner table, you've all been getting ready for or just celebrating recently holidays, where the conversations, I'm quite certain, were very different than they were just a few years ago. The kinds of things that people are worrying about, the impact to their lives, unemployment. We had the murder of George Floyd and the troubles and unrest that brought that forward. Crimes against black communities, Jewish communities, Asian American communities really left, you know, our boardrooms talking about things differently. Families, colleagues at work, and that really pulls forward a lot of these themes of we see in our studies, McKinsey, Bain, the Edelman Trust Barometer, saying how much individuals, employees, folks in the community are looking to companies if the government won't solve this for me, I don't know if I can solve climate change myself, but maybe my employer will. Maybe they'll help guide me on that journey, and we can talk about that and create a sense of belonging. So it's a totally changing universe that we're working in right now. Let's start with the topic of social change. And, you know, I mentioned the pandemic, but that wasn't really the instigator for a lot of these things that we've been seeing brewing under the surface. How do you feel about this evolution you mentioned evolving here at Amgen and on our ESG strategy?
Absolutely. I would say the past couple of years, Judy, really amplified our focus in some areas and elevated the need for focus in others. You mentioned some of the challenges of the year, and we started listening early, took several surveys, had listening sessions, and we quickly realized that our staff members were struggling, right? You know, how do you instantly start, you know, juggling this virtual environment when every day was bring your child to work day, you know, when you think about it, including me.
Very true.
Absolutely. So, you know, we really had to hone in on how to provide, you know, staff support. And we really elevated the focus on mental health and well-being, unlike I've ever before. So it wasn't no longer foreign to really talk about that in the workplace. And I'm really glad about that because it really kind of lessened the stigma about mental health and the importance of it in the workplace and just in life in general. And we're in the business of improving patient lives, right? So we definitely have to invest in our staff members because they are the important asset to help bring this innovation to life, to, you know, help us with our mission to serve patients. So we did several programs throughout the year, over 20 just in this past year, really focused on mental health well-being support for parents who were juggling, to communities of color who were dealing with a lot of the challenges you expressed. And I think it was, you know, well needed, warranted, and it continues, right? So we really needed to provide resources for our staff members. I think another piece too, over the past few years, health disparities have always existed, right? Yeah. But I think the past couple of years really put that conversation because of the pandemic to the forefront, right? There were conversations internally, there were conversations with external stakeholders, with the government on, you know, what can we do more here? And, you know, we've always known at Amgen that, you know, minority representation in clinical trials are important. These communities need to be consulted. They need to be integrated in clinical trials, and they also need to be connected with the financial assistance that allow them to get the care they deserve, right? So, you know, when you think about just if we double click on clinical trials in general, about 40% of the U.S. population identify as a racial or ethnic minority, yet 83% of trials are made up of whites. So, you know, there's a disconnect there. And as you look at certain populations like the Black community, again, 13% of the U.S. population, however, only represent 5% of cancer trials. And when you think about the disproportionate impact on that community, they have the highest mortality rate, they have the shortest survival rate, so they absolutely need to be represented, as our Hispanic population, which is similarly underrepresented. And when I even think about the Asian community, right, they only represent 3% of cancer clinical trials, yet it is the leading cause of death among that population. Right. So we have to, ensure that, you know, minority participation in trials it happens. And some of the things that we've done to invest in that area, we've actually partnered with the Lazarex Foundation. And this was even pre-pandemic. Right. We were working with that organization and we invested in the Impact Program, which was a $3.5 million grant over the next 4 years. And really, the Impact Program, their sole purpose is, how do we increase minority participation in clinical trials? How do you ensure retention? And more importantly, how do you make equitable access to minority patient populations? And really excited about some of the early results of that grant. We know that program right now, we're helping to help that program achieve 63% minority participation in clinical trials, and 52% of those participants are coming from households who make $25,000 or less. So it's saying we're reaching the right population and they're getting that financial assistance they need to get the care they deserve. And one other factor that I would say internally we double down on our investment is by creating a dedicated team called RISE. And RISE stands for Representation in Clinical Trial Research. And this team is dedicated at Amgen to ensure that we increase diversity in our clinical trials, and really excited about the multi-year plan that they have in place to do that, as well as increase awareness. So a lot of work there. So I'm really, granted, it's been a lot and a challenging couple of years, but boy, it helped us elevate focus where I think it was duly needed in a lot of areas.
I'm beaming because as I was walking across campus to come here to see both of you, I met some folks who were saying, go RISE. Oh. So they're very excited. So it's awesome. Not just the thrill of what you can do to help patients, but it's the reward of knowing that the folks in our organization who are working on that are really excited and impassioned. So it brings engagement as well, which is a thrill to purpose-driven mission. Sam, tell me, we hear COP26 in the news, and I just was mentioning how it was snowing in Hawaii yesterday. Well, tell me how things are happening and moving quickly in the sustainability world here at Amgen for you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Judy. Tamika, you spoke about the last couple of years that's been intense. What I'm talking about is going further back than a couple of years, and that's climate change. Mm-hmm. Climate change is having a profound impact on the health of individuals and our community in general. In my opinion, it's a call to action. It's a call to action for us to act now. Call to action to act as individuals and as corporations. You see the rise in climate-related events across the globe. But Judy, we don't have to look very far. Let's look in Southern California, right?
Every day.
Fires, droughts, you worry about these things, and they somehow seem to be a lot worse and a lot more than it was some years back. So we need to do something about this. So as a corporation, let's talk about Amgen. Amgen's a science-based company, and science is guiding our efforts in here. But I go back to the word you use, intrinsic. I think Amgen is trying to be intrinsic in this and trying to integrate environmental sustainability into our operations. And we do aim to be a good steward of the environment. It's important to do as a corporate citizen, certainly, but it's more than that. I think it's also good for the business, because at a time when energy prices are rising and really there's a strain on natural resources, this is the time to look at to see how can we cut down consumption to make what we need to make.
Yeah.
As you say, Judy, we have been at this for some time, right? So we'll talk more about this soon, but this is the third formal initiative that we are starting in 2021. And we call it the road to net zero. Really happy to talk about it here, because the road to net zero, we aim to do three things. One, we aim for carbon neutrality by 2027, carbon neutrality in Amgen's internal operations and facilities. We plan to reduce our water consumed by 40% and waste by another 75%. That's a big number. We are quite ambitious in this. We appreciate it's going to take investment, and we are prepared to do that. I spoke earlier about innovation, and I'll give you a quick example of how innovation can help us get there. We have applied innovation in our manufacturing facilities, and we built two factories in the last few years, one in Singapore and a recent one in Rhode Island. And to give you specific numbers, our factory in Singapore is smaller, more efficient than conventional ones. And we use 70% less carbon and 54% less water to make similar medicine
volumes.
Quality and volumes compared to a traditional facility. And we are continuing this journey. We are going to be building two more factories, one in Ohio and another one coming up in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. And in both of these, our design supports our road to net zero or carbon neutrality by 2027. But I don't want us to think our focus is just on manufacturing. Our focus is on all small and all big events that we can, that makes a difference. Another example would be our global commercial operations officer has asked us to convert a significant portion of our sales fleet to all electric vehicles. In addition to that, we're looking at places where you can be more efficient in our lighting, doing more composting, etc. So as a company, as a corporate citizen, I believe we are doing what we need to do to get to our ambition. But if you allow me a minute more to get on a soapbox in here.
Soap away.
Yes. So, yes, we have responsibilities as corporate citizens, as governments, etc. But I also think we, as citizens of this country and as citizens of the world, have individual responsibilities here to do a lot more. I look at it in 3 points, three R's: reduce, reuse, and recycle. And these are not very complicated things. You know, bike when you can bike rather than drive to work. Take your own little bags into the grocery center rather than asking them every time, and you pay 5 or 10 cents for it now to get that. Compost where you can. All these little things do add up. These behaviors do add up to a very positive change, allowing us to see clearer skies, cleaner water, and yes, a greener earth. This is my dream, and I think we can get there.
We absolutely can get there. I told you he was a very passionate engineer, and I was joking before, when I moved to Germany in the 90s, they gave me a very small garbage can for 2 weeks. Well, what am I going to do with this? And they said, reduce, reuse, recycle, and compost. I didn't know how to spell compost quite yet, but I figured it out. So you too can go to a very small garbage can. Thank you, Sam. Before I forget, just a reminder, feel free to post any questions you might have so that we can come to them later. And, you know, jot down, there have been a lot of statistics thrown your way in the last few minutes, so feel free to share your questions with us. Just sharing a few more statistics, because we want, a numbers person. We put out a 2020 ESG report in the spring of last year, 76 pages of data. Just the highlights, just to share a few items with you. As Sam mentioned, we announced our aspiration to become carbon neutral in 2027, and we met and exceeded those 2020 environmental targets ahead of schedule. And in fact, Sam led a program back to 2013 that got us to those goals that we exceeded last year. As noted in our ESG report, you'll see that approximately $1.5 billion of Amgen medicines were provided at no cost to eligible low-income patients in the United States through our Amgen Safety Net Foundation. And we're proud to say that up to this date, the foundation has never refused a patient request for support. 24 million students were reached in 2020 through the Amgen Foundation Science Programs, which is a terrific marker for last year, with so many students also online. We are a founding member last year of 110, a coalition of companies that aims to collectively hire 1 million Black Americans into well-paying jobs over 10 years, with a specific focus on those without a four-year college degree. And you've heard already Tamika talking about the improvements that we've been making in our clinical trials through collaboration in programs like Lazarex and the RISE program internally, which got started this year. So I just mentioned a few of these things that come back into your area, Tamika. So particularly in the realm of diversity and inclusion, talk to us about the approach at Amgen on our diversity programs, and you mentioned evolving again. So just, you know, how we approach it and how it's continued to evolve.
Absolutely. You know, I think about our approach to diversity, inclusion, and belonging like we approach science in a lot of ways. You know, it's really that continuous.
There we go.
Science, engineering, innovation, evolution. All right, we got it. Good.
Absolutely. But really, you know, what is that continuous learning that we're hearing, you know, learning from our staff, learning from key insights, and how are we building that knowledge over time to really look for opportunities to sustain our diversity, inclusion, and belonging efforts at Amgen. So again, we approach it a lot like science. And I would say over the past few years, we've always had a focus on diversity, but I would say the inclusion and belonging has increased in focus over the past few years. And the thing that we always say is our differences lead to better science, right? And we truly believe that. So it's really, you know, what we're trying to do as an organization is how do you really unlock the power of that diversity? So a lot of that effort really focuses on inclusion and belonging of our staff members. And when you think about the four key areas that we focus on, obviously people, we've talked a lot about that, but our culture, which is critical as well, you know, what are those things that we're doing in our local communities and global communities for that matter? And then, you know, what is the sustainability? Sustainability is just not in, on our environmental side, but it, even in our efforts across a lot of our ESG elements. And, you know, what I when I think even about governance, right, you know, we apply governance to diversity, inclusion, and belonging at Amgen. And really we have, you know, our CEO staff, you know, our diversity, inclusion, executive council is chaired by our CEO, Bob Bradway, and consists of his direct reports. So again, it just ensures that we have that commitment and accountability at the top. But we even took it a step further this past year, and we have over 90% of our executive directors and officers who created DI&B action plans, really focused on inclusive leadership, right? Because we knew at this time where staff members were feeling isolated, you know, it was so important for our leaders to tune in to the needs of staff, and more importantly, create the psychological safety for staff members to feel comfortable, you know, kind of conveying what their needs were. So really an important step I felt we took this year. And then when I think about culture, Judy, wow, our ERG, our employee resource groups have been a critical component this past year. They've created connection and a sense of belonging for staff at a time where it was needed the most. So I'm really proud of how those groups have come together. And we have 11 ERGs, 60 chapters globally with over 11,000 employees that are members. So again, it's been a great source of culture building and community and connection that I don't want to lose sight of. And you know, that effort continues. And when you think about just those things that we're trying to activate in our local communities, our ERGs are an important component of that. And really excited about the Amgen Foundation grants in our local communities where we operate. There was a $7.5 million grant to really advance social justice within the local communities with organizations, you know, in our backyard, right? How can we really, you know, advance that effort on, you know, building a more just and equitable society? And I think we took some big steps in that regard with another 2.5 to be invested over the remainder of the year. So a lot of work going on. And two things that I would add on the sustainability aspect of DI&B, you know, Sam mentioned our two sites. You know, workforce diversity is now part of our site selection process as we look to expand our global footprint in terms of facilities. And when we think about supplier diversity even, right? You know, we have an opportunity to continue to identify and develop diverse suppliers that supply the goods and services to Amgen. And we're really excited that we have an aim by 2023 to double our spend with diverse suppliers and actually triple our spend with Black-owned suppliers. So a lot of work that we can't talk about today. You can go to the ESG report and see a lot more, but just a few of those things that we're doing in our key focus areas.
And so much energy that's been unleashed with the ERGs, not just participation in each group vertically, but the cross collaboration, to your point, building that sense of belonging in communities as well. So creating a sense of belonging in the workplace or the virtual workplace, but also, okay, what are people feeling in their community? Is there more outreach we can be doing? Should the big community doing outreach with our own folks?
Absolutely.
So it's really exciting. Tell me, when we're talking about community, a little bit about 110, just so we...
Absolutely. So really excited about that program as well. A lot of excitement on the stage, as you can see. But we're a founding member of 110, and you talked a little bit about what that aim of 110 is, and it's really a coalition of some of the world's largest and most well-known companies in the world, really collectively coming together with the aim to hire 1 million Black Americans into family-sustaining roles over the next 10 years. And with a specific focus, as you mentioned, on those without a four-year degree. Right. Now, why is that important, right? What we know is that 76% of Black Americans are excluded from family-sustaining jobs despite their skills, despite their experiences, just because they don't have a four-year degree.
Right.
So this is an opportunity to really come together as a coalition to really, you know, shift a paradigm in terms of, hey, skills and experience being an important component to success and not just a four-year degree. So we're really excited to come together in that effort. And we're also the employer city lead in the LA region. And what that really means is, hey, we are garnering the support of like-minded organizations with other partners who share in our desire to create economic stability. In this population, because we know and feel that if you can create economic stability with this group, you can actually exert greater influence on health equity. It's a big component of health outcomes. So to me, it really fits in a nice sweet spot for our mission as well. So excited about, you know, what's to come with that. We're first year in the efforts, but I can tell you just bringing the power of these participating companies together to really shift a paradigm, I think, is pretty groundbreaking and allows us to really advance our social efforts.
Yeah, you have the competitive spirit across the industries, but with a shared, a shared passion about every one of those participants is committed to making their local communities even better. Thank you. Sam, the passionate engineer on sustainability. Tell us a little bit about the programs, because I know you've been doing this before it was a program for many years. So talk a little bit more.
That's correct. You're right, Judy. Although the formal programs really began in the 2007-08 timeframe, I've been in this company since 2003, and environmental sustainability has been around since at least then, maybe even sooner. I can tell you, in the early days of my time here, I'll give you an example. Dr. Margaret Fall, whom you know, who's the Vice President of Manufacturing Clinical Supply here, she's been a proponent and guiding us towards green chemistry approaches. And I'm talking, this is close to 20 years back. So Amgen's been involved in this from a long time back. However, speaking about the formal programs, we started our first program in about 2008, finished two programs, the last of which finished in 2020. Mm-hmm. They've had investments. We have had $50 million or more investments in that. But we've got great results. The best is that we have already obtained, starting from our original baseline, close to 30% savings in our carbon, in our water, and our waste. So we already had that. In addition to that, it's not savings and environmental sustainability are not mutually exclusive. There have actually been savings because of less operational expense costs. But those two are in the past. I'm looking forward now, and we have a road to net zero, right? We spoke about that. But the reason I wanted to talk about the first two is that we have a strong foundation here in this, and we have a credibility. And I believe, and I'm very happy about this, that we've been recognized, for example, by the Dow Jones Sustainability World Index 8 times in a row.
That's terrific. It was in the news again today, the buzzwords of carbon neutrality. It just came out, I believe the President of the United States made a comment about carbon neutrality in terms of government movement and buildings, et cetera. What progress are we making on carbon neutrality? I think we have a specific goal towards 2027. How are we doing?
Absolutely. So as I said earlier, in our road to net zero, we have very specific aims, aspirations that you want to get by 2027 in terms of, let's say, carbon neutrality in our internal Amgen facilities and operations. We appreciate that investments are needed to get us there, and we are making those substantial investments to go there. I believe by 2027, not only would it make us more environmentally sustainable, which is good, and that's the aim, but it'll also help us be more flexible and be more productive, because we use innovation to get there. Once again, showing that environmental sustainability and economic savings are quite aligned. Yeah. So we have set targets, Judy, to the point you made, targets for carbon, targets for water, targets for waste, and we are setting it up for every year. And then we are going to monitor them, and then we are going to make sure that we achieve them. And if we get a little ahead of ourselves, which will be nice, we'll adjust it. But it's not just internal Amgen. Till now, I've spoken about internal Amgen. Yep. We are also interested to engaging with our suppliers. Yep. We have multiple suppliers we work with to assist and to encourage them so that we can obtain carbon reduction across our value chain.
That's great.
Judy, this is a journey. I'm speaking about 2027. We already spoke about the two new factories coming up in Ohio and North Carolina. Life is not static. It's going to be moving and changing.
Right.
So this is a journey with a long-term outlook, and that's what makes it very exciting.
And, you know, Sam and team constantly being very, very disciplined about the metrics and having those conversations about the return on investment. Those capital investments to get to those savings can really show true ROI so that everyone, not just shareholders, all our stakeholders will be able to benefit. It's terrific. I love the passion that you both exude on these topics. I was curious and I wanted to ask the question, you don't just kind of fake excitement about a topic, right? You either feel it or you don't, and your teams will know it and the organization will sense it. And I really do appreciate the energy that you both bring to your jobs. It's infectious. So just where do you think that comes from? Tamika, you didn't just like, oh, when I grow up, I want to be a chief diversity officer. So where does this come from?
Absolutely. I think a lot of where it comes from is really how I grew up. It's probably no surprise that I end up in this seat, but I probably wouldn't have predicted it. I'll say that. But I'll tell you, I just remember stories growing up. My mom was a single mom for most of my adolescence. And boy, I remember her telling stories growing up in the South. She was born in Arkansas in a small town that bordered Mississippi and Louisiana. And she would tell these stories of what I was thinking bravery and courage at that time, of her challenging status quo, advocating for herself and others, at a time where it probably wasn't, you know, fashionable
popular
to do so, let alone safe to do so. But she really instilled in us just confidence in doing that. I remember her, you know, quotes that I'm reminded of, you know, celebrate your uniqueness. And another thing she really instilled in all of us, I'm the youngest of five, and really she instilled in us, you know, as you go on your journey, you know, always look to help others because someone's been there for you. So it was this pay it forward spirit that I think she created in all of us that just makes, you know, this work. Because again, I didn't need the role to do this work. It's something that I've done and I felt passionate about for quite some time. So, you know, I look back and go, oh yeah, she did do that. You know, man, probably not shocking that I do that now. So that really what, you know, fuels me a lot. And I would also say another thing that fuels my passion too is, you know, you don't stay at a company for 20 years unless you're kind of connected to the purpose.
Tamika clearly started in junior high.
I did. And, you know, when I think about, you know, working for an organization that creates life-changing therapies that, you know, we've all in some ways maybe been personally impacted or one degree from impacted by, it's pretty, you know, pretty remarkable and definitely gives you a lot of juice getting out of bed every morning. So, yeah, I would say that's what really drives my passion in the work.
Thank you for the work you're doing.
No, but thank you.
Sam, we've heard his belief in reduce, reuse, recycle. Where does your passion come from?
So clearly it's not coming from just my job and it's only a few years old. This has been with me for a long, long time. I'm a lover of nature. I like doing things outdoors, and you're well aware that I'm a passionate gardener. I love flowers. So you know that this is something I truly, deeply believe in. My passion comes from really, like you, from my youth. I grew up in India, in the southern part of India, and I was there in the 60s and 70s and came to this country after that. So I've been here for a long time. But I go back to India quite often, and I see the impact that industrialization, more traffic, etc., has brought. For example, a city close to where I grew up, a city called Bangalore, when I was growing up, it was truly a garden city. It was green, lush, beautiful. Still a lovely city, but it's maybe not so lush and green now because of all the industrialization, the traffic, etc. But the good news here, things are not bleak. I actually am very optimistic, and I'm optimistic, and I'll give you an example. During the early days of the pandemic when things were all shut down, I talked to family, friends in India. I got you know, some reports from them. They said, wow, I could hear birds sing for the first time in a long time. People from the northern part of India in certain areas said, I can see the Himalayas again, which they haven't seen for a period of time.
Amazing.
So what does this tell us? It tells us that with commitment, with passion, and yes, with innovation, this is, yeah. we can reverse this. We can get it back to a greener earth. And I'm very passionate about it. And I know each and every one of us wants that. And I'm prepared to put in my work to get us there.
Thank you, Sam. And if you ever have the distinct pleasure of having a conversation with Sam from his home office, there will always be the most exquisite bouquet of fresh cut flowers behind him. It brings me joy every time. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
All right, we're at that point where it's time to think about some questions that we're getting. I do have one question coming in for Sam. How is Amgen working to ensure that a circular life cycle plan is in place from all of our products, from an engineering point of view?
That's a really good question, because as I was saying earlier, in engineering, we are accountable for design, build, maintain, but also dispose appropriately. Mm-hmm. So anything we do, whether it's things we build, whether it's things we create, we always look to see how can we take this in a way that we go through the complete life cycle in a way that meets our sustainability goals.
And I would think that's probably the perfect example of continuous process, continuous improvement, right?
That's exactly right. Yeah. Where we are going smaller, more efficient, and constant. Using less resources.
As you've been doing with manufacturing processes, et cetera.
Yes, exactly.
That's terrific. Ah, I have another question for Tamika. All right. How important is it to factor in gender when it comes to equality in clinical trials?
I think it's important as well, right? I think we need to look at all aspects, because there are some diseases that are more predominant in women, and we need to make sure there's adequate representation. So, you know, that's why I'm so glad we have a dedicated team with RISE to really understand the prevalence of a lot of conditions and what can we do to ensure that we have the proper representation. So I absolutely think it's as equally important as minority populations as well.
And what's great to see is how it's being embraced by industry.
Absolutely.
So, you know, proud to be a member of a community of industry members who are all really passionate about this, so we all move the needle forward.
Indeed.
Thank you. Another question for Sam. Mm-hmm. Popular. What is Amgen doing to reduce carbon footprint related to travel?
That's a really good question. And it comes to the point that over the last 2 years, we've had some learnings. They've been very difficult years, but we've had learnings. And we have learned how to do things a little differently. Mm-hmm. So we definitely are, and both of you know this, things that previously we felt we had to travel, we have found different ways of doing that. And I'm not just talking about attending meetings and things. Right. I'm talking, for example, when we build a facility, we use a thing called factory acceptance testing. We test the equipment. And generally, we fly many, many, many people to the factories, usually in a different country, and they do all the work, and then they come back. Mm-hmm. But 2 years back, we couldn't do that. So we learned now how to do this remotely through basically Zoom meetings and using HoloLens, things like that. So I think we have come to a stage, and we can still do better here, where we're really traveling only when we need to, and not traveling just because that was the way it was always done in the past.
Yeah, and all of us sitting on the highway less or going to the airport less can only help keep that mountain view clear in Bangalore.
Yes.
We're about at time, and I wanted to thank those of you who were able to send in your questions, for those of you who've been with us viewing throughout this conversation. Hopefully it's been as much fun for you as it's been for us.
Yes.
I never get tired of listening to the contributions that our very loyal teams are making to help contribute to making the world a better place. Please feel free anytime to click through to Amgen.com to our ESG report. And then we'll be looking forward to publishing a new one soon, next spring, talking about our accomplishments this year through another very, very busy 2021. So we are staying here committed to our employees, to our communities, our stakeholders and our shareholders, and importantly, our patients, to keep moving forward in that purpose-driven mission. So I would like to thank our team here at Amgen for putting together a great opportunity for us to have this conversation today. Thank you. I'd like to thank both Tamika and Sam for joining me today. And thank you to the social community for joining in. It's been great. Thank you all very much.